The first thing that comes to mind when I think of vagus nerve is like the welcome to Las Vegas sign.
Great tip for students out there. It's like, you know, you go through the material, you try to conceptualize it as best as you possibly can, and then you apply the memory techniques. So is there, when you actually get to the specifics, you guys have some examples right now on how you actually take what you've done in the memory world and apply it to the studies?
Yeah, we have some examples.
Yeah, do you want to take the first one? Or I kind of came
yeah,
up with
you
the first,
kind
so,
of, yeah, why don't you do
let me do that. So, yeah, so we, you know, we pretty much use the techniques when we're studying anything these days. So, you know, one easy example of that is when you're learning anatomy. So anatomy is obviously a very memorization heavy discipline. And unfortunately, anatomy was one of those courses that we took right at the beginning of med school, and we hadn't really nailed down the techniques too well. So full disclosure, this is an example that I just came up with because, you know, we don't have that many great ones from anatomy. But, you know, going back to anatomy, if I were to retake it, I definitely would use it. So here's a quick one. So, you know, in medicine, and if you're talking about the digestive tract, there's basically three sections that people split it into. One is called the foregut, and then the midgut and the hindgut. So foregut, midgut, hindgut. You know, so foregut sort of starting at your mouth and going down your esophagus, and not to get into too many specifics, but, you know, one thing you might want to have to remember is the blood supply and the nervous system innervation for each of those sections. So they, you know, part of the reason they're split up into those categories is because they each have a unique blood supply and innervation. So, you know, let's just go through those real quick. So, you know, looking kind of at the room behind us, you know, what would happen in the actual memorization process for us is we would see that, you know, information and decide, okay, I want to commit this to memory using memory techniques. And then say, you know, in our palace at the time, we might be imagining that we're in this particular room. So let's just use that, I guess, as an illustration. So for each foregut, midgut, and hindgut, I would use one locus for each of those pieces. So maybe the first locus that I choose is the ceiling for foregut. So the ceiling would be my foregut locus. And then the blood supply to the foregut is the celiac artery. So part of the reason why I chose the ceiling is because it sounds sort of like celiac. So I can just imagine that because it's the ceiling, I think of celiac artery. And then the innervation is the vagus nerve, cranial nerve 10. So, you know, for that one, the first thing that comes to mind when I think of vagus nerve is like the welcome to Las Vegas sign, or is it Viva Las Vegas or welcome,
it's
welcome
to Las Vegas? Yeah, welcome.
You know, the kind of like, you know, the famous sort of diamond looking sign. So I imagine that, you know, that Vegas sign is hanging from the ceiling. So now, you know, in this ceiling locus, I've got ceiling for celiac artery and the Vegas sign for vagus nerve. So that would be my kind of foregut locus there.
Would you create an image for foregut?
Yeah,
or
so that's a good
question. Would
you question.
Just like know that, okay, this, I know that this is foregut, or would it be an actual image?
So that's kind of a subtle thing that we deal with often, you know, whether or not you kind of encode the topic.
Yeah.
And you know, what I might recommend for kind of people starting out is to do that more. To if you have, you know, kind of a doubt about it, just go ahead and encode the topic as well. So maybe, you know, for foregut, maybe you imagine like, you know,
forehand.
A number four kind of painted on the ceiling or something like that. Basically what we've found is that when you kind of do this process of reviewing a lot, like I mentioned before, you find that the your association of the topic to the locations becomes very natural. So, you know, once you've reviewed a few times that this particular room houses the foregut, midgut, hindgut material, it's almost unnecessary to
it
have that
feels
encoded
like that.
That's and of course there's no perfect way to do it, but that's the strategy that we've kind of fallen into, is, you know, not really encoding that as much.
And both of you have found that this works, right? It's not like, oh, Alex, it works for Alex because he memorizes so often. You as well, right, Cathy? Like this process, if like you just said, it feels like this is the foregut. It feels like this is the midgut area.
Right.
So do you also not have to always encode the actual topic, Cathy?
Yeah, I don't have to. I think when we both started out, one of the things we tried was encoding. But for me, you know, and that's one thing that we like to talk about is Alex is the world memory champion, but I'm just, you know, the world memory champion's wife. Like, you know, so I don't do these techniques competitively, but it definitely works for me. And just the other day, we were in our hometown. And we've, you know, sprinkled these palaces all over our hometown where we grew up. And we were just driving around and we were like, oh my gosh, like it just feels like cardiac stuff here. You know, you kind of have that sense. And one thing we even thought was pretty funny was we've been walking around in these places in our minds so much that it almost feels like we've been there recently, you know?
Yeah. So,
it's such a weird feeling.
I had mentioned before.
It is.
That we recently went to Baltimore, which is where I went to college at Johns Hopkins. And, it was weird because I haven't been there in almost 3 years now, but I would go back to some of these places on my you know, home campus and feel like I was just there because I had been, you know, using it for
so
various
actively
things,
using
which
it.
Is interesting.
Yeah. That is weird. I memorized the Avengers movie, or like scenes from the Avengers. I use that as a memory palace. And I use that, where did I use that? The World Memory Competition for cards. So I was training for that heavily, that route specifically. And then I just saw a poster of the Avengers somewhere, I don't know where, but I saw the poster and then it just triggered, like the entire movie just kind of flashed in my mind. I was like, oh, that's insane.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But that's so true. Like, it triggered like memories from the World
it
Memory
feels
Competition.
Like it, yeah.
That. Here's the thing. I think the biggest takeaway is like, be okay with creating these locations because that's, you know, what the top people are doing right now. You know, the Mullen family is doing. They're creating these locations to store the information. So be okay with creating the location and don't get overwhelmed with the idea that you have to have thousands of locations right from the get-go before you can get started with learning information. You can start just by thinking of your home right now
exactly.
And then place information along that route, just like what we're about to go into during the next few examples.
So. You know, when I'm thinking of the palace, I never look at pictures or like go to the actual palace, right? So in my mind, I just use the first thing that comes to mind. Maybe it's like the stairs, you know, down sort of there. I don't know if you can see them right there. So, you know, let's make that the Midgut, for instance. So I'm going to go ahead and imagine Lionel Messi standing there on top. You know, maybe it's kind of a more miniature version of him standing on those steps, holding up a Vegas, one of those same Vegas signs above his head, like kind of in a victorious way. And so now I'll explain what those are for. So that's the Midgut, and then the blood supply to that is the superior mesenteric artery. And so Messi, you know, Lionel Messi, world famous soccer player, is kind of representing that superior mesenteric, Messi mesenteric. And then he's kind of looking victorious. So that's kind of how I encoded the superior part. And you'll see that's important because the next thing for the hindgut is the inferior mesenteric. So, so he's holding up kind of the victoriously. You got Messi for mesenteric holding up this Vegas sign. And that's because the vagus also does the nervous system, the innervation to the midgut. So he's, you know, got that vagus sign, superior mesenteric vagus. And then maybe the next place is the kind of couch, or I'll just use over here. You know, maybe we're doing that painting there. Maybe that's in my memory palace. And hindgut, it's inferior mesenteric for the artery and pelvic nerve for the nerve. So, you know, again, I'm going to use some sort of messy type image for the mesenteric. So maybe now we have messy on that counter there, and he's just sort of slumped on the ground, feeling like maybe he's injured or something like that in a game, and he's feeling very inferior. So it's inferior mesenteric, and then the innervation is the pelvic nerve. So pelvic, I just think of Elvis. This is the first thing comes to mind. So maybe
pelvic thrust.
So you got Elvis sort of bending over Messi, you know, seeing what's wrong with him, maybe trying to help. So you just got that, you know, all these images, you know, you can remember the Vegas sign, you know, ceiling for celiac. You got victorious Messi with the Vegas sign, and you've got Elvis and Messi over here. And that would just be some quick cues to key you into the different blood supplies and innervations.
So here's a question that I often get.
Yeah.
When you're reviewing the information, right? So you're seeing the stories, you're seeing Elvis bending over trying to help out Messi. You have no, many times, especially like during the first like review, you might get one or two like real triggers, meaning you'll get one or two like translations for what that visual represents. But sometimes you're like, I have absolutely no idea what Elvis was doing or what Elvis represented. Does that ever happen to you guys where you're like seeing these images when you're reviewing and you're like, what did that even, like, why did I picture that person or doing that action? Does that ever happen to you guys?
Sometimes,
yeah.
Yeah. and the way I usually handle that is if it's something that I think is not immediately obvious to me why that image is what it is, in my note of that mnemonic, so like Cathy said, we have, you know, this way of taking notes, I'll write like, you know, Elvis, and then I'll write equals pelvic nerve. You know, and so that way, if there's any if I think there might be any confusion about what it represents, I'll have that note there, and I can always go back and see what it was.
Gotcha. Okay. So you guys take extensive notes on all of this. It's not just like you're storing it on the location and then you walk away and that's it. Like you actually go back and you do your note taking on top of like creating these visuals, right?
Yeah, it's like you said earlier, right? It's kind of misleading if you just think about it as like, oh, I put it in there and now I don't ever have to, review it again, right? So that's one of the things is we do take notes on it. That way we can consistently review it in the same way that we encoded it so that it just, we're not kind of imagining something different every time and then it's all messy. Messy.
Pun intended.
Yeah.
No. Cool. And so, okay, here's another one. Reusing characters or like images that you've already used for other terms. So if you have, is there anything else that you would use messy for? Or like, and we'll stick with that example just because we used it twice already. So if you ever see like messy again, will that always represent something that has to do with the gut? Or would you use messy like that player for something completely separate and different if you see that term somewhere else?
So we try to keep it consistent so that if we saw messy again, it would be something to do with the mesenteric arteries. And that's actually part of what Alex was talking about in terms of organization, because that does allow us to kind of quickly scan through and say, where have I seen messy before? And then you just start having this sense, right? The sense that we were talking about earlier for when you see that image, what it means, all the things associated with it. It's one thing I say is like, if I asked you to think about all the pizza places in your hometown, you can easily think of, where all the pizza was and everything that kind of is associated with those restaurants. And so when we keep those images consistent, it kind of allows us to do that quick scanning and quick thinking.
Yeah. And so just to add on to that, we try to keep those images consistent for sure. The one thing we might do like is we try not to reuse the images. So like if something else comes up that sort of sounds like messy, I will do my best to not make it messy again, just because it can sometimes get confusing if you've got a bunch of messies running around that are doing different things. But what I will say is that like if maybe if let's say the inferior mesenteric vein comes up, mesenteric veins obviously are a little different than the arteries. What I might do just to kind of come up with an image for that easily is use some sort of category. And so maybe I'll imagine like a different Argentinian soccer player for the veins, right? So it'll be so every time I think messy, it'll be just for the mesenteric arteries, and then maybe there's this, maybe it's the Argentine goalkeeper, and I have no idea who that is, but just kind of the general notion that it's that goalkeeper or somebody else will cue me into it being the mesenteric veins instead of the
Because it
arteries.
does feel related that way.
Right.
Right. Because then at that point, you're seeing a soccer player,
Right.
and you're like, wait, okay, well, that was messy, but that was an artery. Oh, this one must be the vein, right?
Right.
Yeah.
And it would trigger that. So that's a good tip right there. It's kind of like similar to when I memorize names, when we memorize names and faces. So for me, like for every owl, like a owl, I picture the bird, an owl, right? And Alex, I'll picture like an owl flexing. So maybe I'll like change it up a little bit. An Albert is like an owl, but his body is a burrito. So he's just like the top of the head popping out of
Right.
a burrito. So it's like I'll use something similar, which is an owl, but then I'll like morph it into something else. For you morphed it into like another soccer player, right? So it's still messy in a way, but it's just, a soccer player.
Yeah.
Not
yeah.